Hey, welcome. We're glad you're here today. I'm John. This is Trayton, and you are here to worship with us as a part of the Milan Christian Church and the Story Church of Greensburg, Indiana. I'm representing IU today in honor of all those grads, but especially one in particular, my daughter Kate. And congratulations. You've got great things ahead of you, all the graduates. We love you. We're going to talk about restoration today and how in not allowing ourselves to be totally broken and totally committed, we carry around our past, and that's going to keep us from a bright future. And that's what we're going to look at. We're going to talk about charcoal. We're going to talk about fish. We're going to talk about Peter. And we're going to talk about restoration. But before we do that, we're going to be led in worship by this young man right here. Trayton?
Hey, guys. I just wanted to kind of talk about one of the songs we're going to sing today. We're actually even repeating this song. I introduced it maybe a few weeks ago, but it's called This We Know. And this song just kind of, you know, just states the fact that we live because of his victory. And we're seeing the enemy run. We're seeing him kind of even escape at the matter of declaring the name of Jesus, and also just realizing that, man, we are all set and ready to go when it comes to life, because we have salvation and we have his love and grace that's poured out on us. But before we even begin worship, I just want to take this time to pray. You just allow God to, you know, just be in the presence, and also for us to surrender throughout this time. So pray with me. God, we just want to thank you so much for this opportunity to worship you. We're so thankful for what you've done for us. We thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross for our sins, so that way we can live true life and eternal life. Father, be with us as we worship. We totally just want to surrender and also just give you glory today. You're worthy of our praise, God. In your Son's name.
Was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing, but failures I tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness to your glory stay. sin was heavy, the chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, now you're
trust you, your ways
Yes, Jesus, you are unfailing.
Thanks, Trayton. That song, it's just getting dearer and dearer to me as we just are reminded that this we know, that we will see the enemy run, and this we know, that we will see the victory won. We know this for sure, and it's so beneficial, and it's so great to have that hope in this midst of a time when there just seems to be misinformation all over the place, or just trying to figure out who's giving us the real deal. But this we know, that Jesus remains, that the tomb is still empty, that God is still on his throne. Great words, great words. So what informs us? And we have to believe that there's a story that we are supposed to be in, and it's a story that is bigger than us, and because of that, it's a story that makes us bigger. And I believe that Satan smells like charcoal and sounds like a rooster. And we've been told that our past doesn't equal our future, but living in the same town you grew up in, kind of question that a little bit, because when I drive through town, it is like a tour of past failures. A reputation precedes me. Satan reminds me. And I got to be honest with you, it can haunt me. And if we're honest, I don't think I'm alone. So we all have a tendency to be haunted by our past. And sometimes we let our past sabotage our future. And we stay paralyzed. We stay unresurrected, we stay unrestored. And I'm afraid that during this pandemic that Satan is having a field day with that. There's so much of this time that we're spent reflecting or thinking or by ourselves, that we can easily go back to where we messed up, where it went wrong. You see, I think we run the highlight reel for everybody on the outside, the public, our family and friends, the social media. I'm fine, there's no problems. But the blooper reel, the one that has all the times when we trip up or mess up or just flat out sin, that blooper reel is on a continuous loop in our heads. And I think, unfortunately, too many of us have been convinced that the blooper reel is as good as it's going to get. The Satan tries to neutralize us spiritually by getting us to focus on what we've done wrong in the past. But Jesus comes into our life to recondition our spiritual reflexes, to transform us into revolutionaries for his cause. Last week, we looked at John's Gospel, the 21st chapter, and we read about a fishing trip. Peter said, "I'm going fishing," and he had some of his buddies follow him, and they went out fishing, and they didn't have any luck at all. All night they fish, no fish, empty nets. As morning comes and they're getting ready to come back to shore, they see a man on the beach, a figure, and he yells out, "Hey, do you have any fish?" And they say, "No." And he says, "Well, put your nets on the other side." And they did. And they had a huge catch of fish. And that's where we pick up with our scripture today, starting John's Gospel, the 21st chapter, verse 7. "That disciple whom Jesus loved, therefore, said to Peter, 'It is the Lord.' And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far off from land, but about 100 yards off." So Peter hears it. He hears that it's Jesus, and immediately he grabs his coat, and immediately he jumps out of the boat, because he does things on impulse. It's his way of doing things. But I'm wondering if the reason he wanted to get to shore quick after knowing it was Jesus is because it was guilt that sent him fishing. It was guilt as he sat around with the disciples that maybe made him think, "Well, I'm not worthy to be here." Maybe it was that guilt that was just weighing him down so heavy. So he heads towards shore, and he heads towards grace, because he'd experienced that grace before, and he longed for it again. Mark Batterson said this, that the grace of God is the difference between drowning in guilt and swimming in gratitude. pick up at verse 9. And when they got on land, they saw a charcoal fire in place with fish laid out on it and bread. And Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. And Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. And this was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. Now I want you to take note of this real quick, that Jesus already had fish ready for him. He was the guy that asked him if he had any fish, and they said no, and he was like, well, come have breakfast. Here's the fish. Here's the bread. Jesus already had the fish ready to feed the disciples. Now, I don't know what you're searching for. I don't know what you're seeking. I don't know what you're hungry for. But I know everything that you need, Jesus already has. And he's waiting for you. So Peter races to shore to be welcomed by the aroma of a charcoal fire. And it had to bring up a sense of deja vu. I believe that Satan smells like charcoal and sounds like a rooster. Because any good campfire or any good grilling session, you carry the smell with you, like a memory. Well, on the night that Peter betrayed Christ, he stood around a charcoal fire. And three times, Peter denied Christ. Three times. And on the third time, a rooster crowed in the darkness. I believe that Satan smells like charcoal and sounds like a rooster. It's not hard to imagine that as Peter reaches shore and the day was breaking, there had to be a rooster around there somewhere that crowed. His senses were flooded with his past. It's not hard to imagine guilt crashing back in on him. Not hard to imagine this conversation going on in his head. How can I possibly be anything other than what I once was? Why would Jesus want to have anything to do with me? He told me I was going to deny him, and I did. How can I ever get back to that relationship we have? How can I ever get past the failings of my past? Verse 15. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, feed my lambs. He said to him a second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said to him, tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter was grieved because he had said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. And Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Jesus asked this first question twice. He goes, do you love me more than these the first time? And I don't know what these referred to. Maybe it was the disciples. Maybe it was fishing success. Maybe it was life before that Peter had without Jesus. I don't know. But I think the question confronts Peter's issue, and that's pride. Because, see, before all of this blew up in Peter's face, Peter had proclaimed a superior love for Christ. In Matthew's gospel in the 26th chapter, verse 33, it reads, Peter answered him, though they all fall away, because of you, I will never fall away. So now, does Peter still have this proud estimation of his devotion? I don't think so. I think he realizes how shallow that statement was. I think he realizes how frail his commitment was. And so Jesus asked him, do you love me more than these? And he asked about a love that is
agape, all giving, all encompassing, without a cause. It's just there. It's unselfish love. Do you love me more than these? With everything that you've got. And Peter replies, I am your friend. Because Peter answers with filial love. It's reciprocal. Well, if you're my friend, I'm your friend. It's a friendly affection. So now all of a sudden, Peter is a lot more reserved in his proclamation of devotion. And that happens. That happens when we feel that we have failed Christ. We push him away. We set up barriers. We hide from him. We friend zone him. Because friends can be kept at a distance. Friends can be fooled. Jesus can't. Jesus looks at Peter and says, do you love me? And he says, yeah. Yeah, we're good, Jesus. So Jesus says, feed my sheep. Go back to work. See, for Peter to follow through with that love for Jesus, he must give himself to the service of God's people. And it's the same for us. The love we proclaim for Jesus is verified by the love we show others, all others, even the ones that don't like our Facebook post. Three times, Jesus asked Peter the same question, do you love me? And on the third time, Peter is grieved. His heart's broken. Because he said, why are you still asking me this? And so Peter plays on the omniscience of God. He says, Lord, you know all things. And Jesus asked Peter if he does in fact have a friendly devotion. Are we pals? And Peter answers, you know. You know all things. And I think Jesus answers back and says, I know. I know all things. But do you know that I still call you friend? Do you know that whatever happened in the past isn't keeping me from loving you and wanting to restore you? So I don't know what it is. There's somebody out there that is watching this and they're just this close to this relationship with Jesus. And they hear preachers all over the place say that Jesus loves you and that you're forgiven and you can't quite get over the hump of what you've done. And you're convinced that there's no way that it can ever be restored. Did Jesus ask you, do you love me? I like you a lot. We're pals. So he says, feed my sheep. And he keeps asking us, do you love me? To the point where we get kind of flustered and fed up and we say, you know I love you. You know all things. And I think that's when Jesus wants to come into our hearts, into our lives and say, I do know all things. But do you know that I love you? Do you know? I still count you as precious, that I still call you friend. See, as we look at how Jesus and Peter interact here, we realize that Jesus restores us by causing us to face squarely our point of failure, then challenging us to set our eyes on the work ahead. Jesus doesn't ask, are you sorry? Or will you promise to never do that again? Jesus Christ asks each one of us, not primarily for obedience, not for repentance, not for vows, not for conduct, not for tradition, not for church attendance, but for a heart. And that being given, everything else is going to follow. This is the conversation that God wants to have with you. And it's going to start the same way it did with Peter. He's going to ask you one question. Do you love me? And he phrases it to make us confront our past, not because he's mad at us. And he phrases us so that we confess our sins, not because he's disappointed in us. And he phrases it so that we will receive his grace and forgiveness and go about his business of changing the world. So do you love Christ more than your stubbornness, pride, unforgiveness, your sin? Do you love Christ more than the times when someone didn't love you back the way you needed and should have been loved? Do you love Christ more than all the times that you've been let down and disappointed until you start telling yourself, this is as good as it gets? We have to let go of these things before we can truly love, before we can truly say that we love Christ above all else. Because here's the deal. If our encounter with God does not require something of us, then we need to really ask ourselves if we've really encountered God. So here's some steps. Steps for you to escape from your old life and embrace your resurrected life. They're simple. Do the next right thing. Seek the godly thing and love his sheep. Love people. Serve them. Enough junk in the world right now. Everybody knows what we're mad about. Feed his sheep. Because here's the deal. Christ did not fight hell with the weight of all our sins, then defeated death to leave an empty tomb so that we can continue to give lip service to his love, his grace, and forgiveness, and live out the past life that he loved us enough to rescue us from. So what do we do with this? Quit settling for and hiding behind, I'm fine. I'm fine in my marriage. I'm fine in my relationships. I'm fine in my career. I'm fine in my walk with God. It happens when we admit that we're broken. It happens when we admit we're not there yet, that we don't have all the answers, and we're looking for the one who does. Restoration will not happen until we admit our need to be restored. So be honest where you're at with Christ. Is it an all-in love? An unconditional love? The kind of love that loves him when he doesn't quite bless you the way you thought he should bless you, or it doesn't pan out the way you thought it should? You're all in? Or is it a filial love? Like, we're good, we're bros. Jesus is my bro. That is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. He is not your bro. He is the Lord and Savior of life, or he is nothing. Which is it? To get to the point where you're honest with Jesus, and Jesus smiles and he just says, good, we'll start here. Three things that I want you to remember. No matter your past, Jesus is ready to not only forgive, but to restore. To be restored, you must be honest about your spiritual condition. And when you're honest with God, be prepared for God to be honest with you. Because he loves you. Because he calls you friends. Every day is Easter Sunday. Every day the tomb is empty. And if Jesus saved you from your past, then stop allowing your identity to be established by it. I believe that Satan smells like charcoal and sounds like a rooster. And he'd like nothing more than to rob you of your future. But Christ knows your heart inside and out. And your past will never stand up to a life that is his. Christ knows what's in your past. Christ knows what's in your future. He knows what's in your heart. He knows the you he created you to be. And that's amazing. The world is not going to be transformed by untransformed people. We are resurrected to be revolutionaries. We are resurrected to be transformed. We've been resurrected to change the world. Pray with me. Father God, the enemy is keeping us from you by reminding us of all that we did that grieved you. But that grief was never enough for you to stop loving us, to stop inviting us, to stop welcoming us, to stop you from spreading out a breakfast buffet of grace and forgiveness. You are the one who restores. You are the one who rebuilds. Let us come to you. And Lord, when you ask if we love you and we say you do, you're going to say the same thing to us that you said to Peter. Feed my sheep. Tend my lambs. Love my people. That's what a church looks like. It's not a service. It's not a building. It's an army. An army who loves. An army who's been restored. An army who's been transformed. And governments and conspiracy theories and viruses don't stand a chance in hell against an army like that. And we give you praise. In your name we pray. Amen. You're sitting out there, maybe you've heard this, and you've stayed long enough to get to this point, and you're like, I don't want to be hiding anymore. I don't want to run off. I don't want to hear roosters and smell charcoal. I don't want to be defined by who I was. Then I invite you to sit down with Jesus. Be honest with him. There'll be ways to contact us put up here in a minute. You need a chance to talk to somebody. I would love to tell you about a restoring Savior. Your best life is in front of you, not because of anything you've done, because everything he's done. That's you today, man. I really hope we get to hear from you. But if we don't, I want you to remember that he loves you. Always has. For the rest of us, still the same old crazy world, isn't it? So I'll end it like I have the last couple of weeks. I don't know what the news is going to say tomorrow. I have no idea, but I know this. I know that the victory's won. I know that the tomb is empty. Because of that, I can say without hesitation, we got this. He's got us. Peace.
Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. Oh, I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. No, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything. And more than anything that you can do, I just want you. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. Nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else. Nothing else will do. Caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. Never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. You don't owe me anything, and more than anything.